so if I kind of make this worth your time, tough to compete against those. What we're going to try to cover is where I believe the research shows the world is moving very quickly, where there is a $1 trillion opportunity on the horizon that no one company has the lead in. And I have the privilege to get to work with all the leading companies in the space, our clients. And so let's have some fun. Make it interactive in the sense that I'll leave time for any pressing questions. For those of you that really like to get facts, figures, and numbers, sit up front. I keep them small. For those that like pretty pictures, sit wherever you like. So I'm Jay Samet. Thanks for coming. And before we go into the future, before we talk about what's about to happen, we really have to go back and understand how we work in our environment. Because unless you understand reality, it's tough to understand the differences that an augmented reality will be. And to go back, I literally have to go back to the beginning. It works. I told you I'd go back to the beginning. The most basic question that humans face is what separates us from all the other animals? And when I was in school, we were taught we had language, animals have language. We were taught we have tools, animals have tools. The big fundamental difference that has separated mankind for the past several thousands of years, 10, 20,000 years, is we figured out a way to store information outside of our bodies, so that we can pass information on, even if we're not around, even if we're not alive, and that information can be built upon. So I'm pretty sure that 10,000 years ago, when our forefathers painted these things on the walls, they weren't doing an art exhibition. They were pretty much saying, hey, here's how we're gonna kill the guy. Ugh, you go over there. Ralph, you hide over there. Very popular name, Ralph. And that was the basis of storing knowledge in our environment. We learn from our environment and we can pass that knowledge on. We fast forward to about 5,000 years ago. This is the oldest sign known in existence. It's in Turkey. And about 14,000 years ago, we started living in towns and villages. And this is a sign of here's the village, here's the huts. And if you go past the huts, there's a mountain that spews rocks and lava on you. Don't go this direction. So it's the first warning sign to keep in mind. A very key piece of augmenting our environment is thou shalt not have harm. Then quickly, we get really specific. We figure out written language, and that really helps. And then we go 500 years ago, and Gutenberg gets the printing press going. And the fundamental difference there is we now have dissemination of knowledge at a scale the world had not seen before. So the more that we can build on knowledge, the more people have access to knowledge, the faster times change, which is now each of you has a supercomputer in your pocket that connects you to 7 billion people. Think about that for a second. You only have to be right for a nanosecond to become a billionaire or change the world. Whatever your goal is, you have that power. Matter of fact, every 48 hours, a new self-named billionaire is created on Earth. What are you doing, Pastor? So it's something to think about the power that we have. And so now we've taken all this technology, millennial knowledge, and we put it together, and I cannot figure out if I'm allowed to park in Los Angeles at this spot. And I can tell you, yes, I'm a college graduate who paid $434 because I couldn't comprehend the sign in my environment. So why do we have augmented reality? The purpose is to make life easier. All this complication is meant to make life easier. So if you were hiking with me in the rainforest of Costa Rica, and if you're ever able to go, it's the most beautiful thing in the world, until you realize everything there is designed to kill you. Don't touch the plant, it cuts you, it kills you. Those ants are worse than the vipers, everything's trying to kill you. And you get bit by a snake, and you're wearing your AR glasses. You don't want to know the Latin name of that snake. There's only one thing I want to know. I want to know, is it poisonous, or who can I call in 3 minutes? That's the purpose of AR, is to add information when we need it. And here's the advantage. We've spent since Google, and no one remembers how we learned anything prior to Google, we've spent our time searching for knowledge, asking questions, getting better at Boolean logic to get the answers that we most need. But you're now going to see that most of what we spend our time doing, there are companies, we'll talk about privacy in another conversation, that know where we are, why we're here, how often we've been here, what we've done, that we haven't eaten lunch, that we normally eat at a certain fast food chain. It's 1 o'clock in the afternoon, he hasn't stopped to eat. If I show him free French fries, will he walk in the door? Okay? That's where we're headed. And so, what I want to talk about the size of this is the fourth transformation of computing, and probably the last major one that I'll get to see in my lifetime. So the first one was when we got the PCs, and I'm from that generation. And if you go back and watch early 1980s PC commercials, buy this PC for $2,500 and YouTube can balance your checkbook. They had no idea what we'd do with the PC, but we learned to come up uses. Then we fast forward and Andreessen put the web on, and suddenly we were able to communicate vast stores of knowledge. So taking that cave painting on steroids to the point that anything that you want to know, anything that is known, is somewhere on that world wide web. And you can stay up all night and you'll never find the end. I tried. But then that wasn't good enough. We decided we wanted to take all of mankind's knowledge and have a relationship with everybody on the planet anytime we wanted. And all this went to mobile. Today in the US, the average human being spends 5 hours a day staring at that screen while they walk into the glass walls at their new headquarters, while they walk into that pole. It doesn't make sense. When in fact, what I'm saying is you're going to have a world very quickly where you're going to have glasses that are this lightweight. These are actual AR glasses. And there's lighter ones that they wouldn't let me show you, and ones that beam into the back of the eyeballs that they still won't let me show you. And if you want the scientific way, it's witchcraft, but it's absolutely amazing that you will see images, and because you're beaming to the back of the eyeball at the back, we all have the same vision, so it doesn't matter if you're wearing your glasses, it's perfect, and it's opaque. So somebody can walk behind the object, you cannot tell the difference between an augmented object and a real object. So how can we now use this technology to conspire to solve more problems? And so that's the journey I want to take you on, of some of what businesses are doing today, some of where they're headed, and why I'm so excited. If you could play the video for me and just scroll it to the midpoint. Just advance a little bit. It's not letting you do that?
I can't find this.
You can't find the little scroll bars? Don't worry about it. Just play the video when I'm talking. So, if you get a chance, this video's on YouTube, it's called Hyperreality, and it shows a dystopian view of what happens when every brand gets to augment our life. If you remember when PCs had pop-up ads, nobody liked that unless you were 14. What you're talking about is a world where it will be so crazy, it'll be like in Times Square on acid, okay? So your phones can chatter everything. But as you get in later to the video, you want to cross the street. If you've ever been to London, they have all that stuff, you know, idiot, look the other direction, spray painted. The street will turn red when you shouldn't be in it. It'll turn green when you can be in it. It'll turn yellow when you should run like the Dickens, okay? So there's some basic UI, UX that we can do to our environment to make it better. And so this takes a look at some of that, and in the midpoint of this video, the person gets hacked. So what happens when your reality gets altered, gets your will. So really interesting way to look at things. But we shall move past it and talk about the first thing. So Gartner's a company that looks at all the exponential new technologies, and it happens to know as the Gartner hype cycle. And everything comes out with this big bang, like, oh my God, 3D TV is going to change the world, 3D printing is going to change the world. You have no idea how great it is. And then we get to the trough of disillusionment. This crap wasn't as good as I thought it was. Aren't they selling this? Nothing's changed, okay? It's just another type of soap with a new label on it. What you're going to see is that VR and AR have finally come out of that trough and are now solving real problems. We have clients that are solving billion-dollar bottom-line savings, that I'll show you, using the state of the technology today. and we're still in an early stage. I'm with Deloitte. Every Deloitte person has to show a graph. This one's mine. The only thing that's meaningful here is this one on the bottom right quadrant. I learned the word quadrant. That's how I got to be vice chairman. And what you see is the red line is television advertising. Keeps on going up, doing really well. And all of a sudden, May of last year, for the first time, internet advertising exceeded it globally. Two companies now, more than 50% of global advertising. But that's again for a second. If we're no longer going to be looking at our phone, whoever controls this controls CPG products, controls branding, controls education, controls who sits in the White House, controls a lot of things. So when I say this is a $1 trillion opportunity over the next 5 years, that isn't hype, that's actual numbers. And what it comes down to is, how are we going to use this? What brands are we going to trust to augment our life? And who gets left in the dustbin of history because they didn't do it? Now, augmented reality has been around for a long time. If you've been to the Haunted Mansion in Disneyland and you see the ghost going around, it's an effect called the ghost. If you watch football and you see the first yard line in yellow, it's really not there. So why suddenly all this excitement? And what's driving it is all the exponential technologies that are hitting at the same time to bring this to you. So augmented we're talking about, but you're going to have to do an awful lot of that knowledge in the cloud to keep it close to where the person is. And you're going to have edge computing to do most of the processing in the cloud and not on your body, where you're going to use too much battery. You're going to need 5G to get more of that stuff to you back and forth quickly. You're going to want to have Internet of Things, more things communicating to let you know where you are, what you're doing, why you're doing it, what you want to change. And you're going to want to have AI or machine learning, and they're two very different things when we get into what they are. If you want to really solve these problems and learn and make the systems better and more efficient. All of these are at a useful enterprise stage today, meaning that the equipment is cheap enough and the output is beneficial enough that industry is using it. You're going to quickly see this become consumer when everything changes. So I don't make up the numbers. When people talk about $1 trillion, we're talking about 2025, it's over $500 billion spent. Now 2025 to me sounds like so far in the future until you remember it's 2018. So we're talking less than 7 years. And how do I constantly predict the future and do this for a living? I hang out with the people that are coding it, and then I just take credit for their work. Everybody that has products coming out over the next 3 years, those things are in development. Everybody that's doing anything in the life sciences and has to go through clinical trials, there are contact lens versions of these glasses that one of our clients has right now. I met with their head of engineering. I made them talk really, really slow. I didn't understand how they work, but that they do work. So the idea that you can do this, and not just for silly augmentations, but monitoring your health, knowing your blood pressure, knowing if you have diabetes because your opinion's changed. Technical term, I'll stop there. So what's going to happen is there's a huge economic change that's going to shift as these things go and collude and collide to really change how we live in our home and outside of our home. And if I would have told you 10 years ago that you would spend 5 hours a day staring at the phone in your hand, your only response would be, did I have a stroke? Okay. Why would anybody look at a phone? And now I don't have to explain that. So making the leap that that phone will not leave your pocket, that you'll have this expansive look, shouldn't be that hard of a leap to understand. And when we talk about, and this, everybody has a different stats, it's not important, the numbers, it's to see the size of the jump from 2018 at $17 billion to $141 billion in 2019. The inflection point's about to come, and that inflection point is based around this. You can do almost any AR app today with a tablet or a phone. 750 million humans played Pokemon Go. So it's not a lack of consumer awareness. It's not it's too complicated or people don't want to do this. It's a lack of people coming up with something worth spending your time doing that can compete with something as valuable as your time as might be. So, from a sense of the speed of growth, there is no industry that is growing at a faster rate, where more profits will be spent. And when we talk about the existential threat to existing industries, and you can name them all, we'll cover a whole bunch that will change, great opportunity. The big companies are not going to invent all these solutions, they're going to buy them to stay in. And that speed of change will be massive. And you've already seen some of the massive acquisitions and massive investments in some of the companies in the space. And as they used to say, Broadway ain't seen that. In terms of where it's going to be, and I apologize for the looms on this, but video games already huge, live events. So today, for those of you that are sports fans, you go to the football stadium and you quickly realize that your at-home experience is vastly superior than even the plush and box seat at a stadium. You don't know when that guy gets injured, what happens to your fantasy team. With AR, you can instantly see and track all of that. You can see whatever stats you want. You can see the replay from whatever angle you want to see. You can have a more in-depth argument with the person next to you with factual evidence. You can order food. You can really record, share, spend more time on detail. And the venue can know who shows up early, what their patterns are, how to make the environment more engaging. And we're working with three major teams right now in the future stages. And when we get then to some of the smaller ones, retail, brick and mortar has been dying. The number of stores that closed this year exceeded 2008 in the height of the recession. It looks this week that Toys R Us is going bye-bye. I'm not a Toys R Us kid. I love Toys. Brick and mortar will have a resurgence thanks to AR, and I'll explain why in a couple more slides. But the main difference will be you will leave your home to have an out-of-home experience that you can't do at home. People originally went to the movie theaters to see a movie because they could sit at home and listen to radio. That was the competition. Now we have so many screens and you can have VR, you know, an IMAX experience at home. But now you can go to retail and they can have virtual inventory. They can make customized things right in front of you. They will have the bandwidth. There's a thing called Li-Fi. Instead of Wi-Fi, it uses lights, and lights can go on and off an infinite number of times in a second. At 100 times the throughput of data as Wi-Fi. So now you can have environments that are really magical, especially if you want to go and do. When you start going into healthcare, education, real estate, and engineering, being able to see through walls, firemen walking through a building that's completely smoke-filled, and will know where the walls are and where there's not. You know, never will you dig up again and hit some cable and shut out the electricity for the rest of the neighborhood. So superpowers are what you get. This chart has lots of colors. That's how I got to be all the way up to vice chairman. This shows the stack, and it doesn't really matter what all those industries are. What it really shows is it is going across every sector. Entertainment, oil and gas, manufacturing, hospitality, telco. All these are now utilizing this, I say. And last year, sorry to go back, 40% of all venture investments last year went into AR and VR. Huge amount. The company Improbable raised $500 million. If you don't know who they are, you will, they raised $500 million. Unity, one of the key tools, raised $200 million. There is no shortage of capital to fund your idea in these spaces. And this shows you how many companies have invested in this, which is basically every logo I could find. There is not a major company that isn't saying, how does this impact them? In the same way they said, will we relate to the web? Will we relate to coming out with our app? What should we be doing? How should we do it? And then you talked about enterprise level. Again, education, healthcare, jumping out real early, retail. All these because they're facing huge issues that can be solved. And we'll get into real specifics. And last one of the charts is there's a huge shortage of skilled labor with these skills. So there's two ways to suddenly double your salary. You either put that you're an expert in this or a data scientist. Mm-hmm. You will instantly get hired by one of the big Silicon Valley companies. 60 days later, they find out you're not a data scientist. That's not the bad part. But now you're the former data scientist of such and such and Silicon Valley, and you're the first, second, rest of your life. So, top employers that are real, you know, Facebook was hiring everybody, Intel, Amazon. These are the places that are really investing heavily. Healthcare, huge investments, huge growth. And what's tying in back to those exponentials is wearables. So augmentation, I come from LA, it means something different there, but augmentation is not just about eyewear. It is chatbots. It is being able to talk with your environment. Hey Google, call Alexa, she's jealous that I'm talking to you. So more and more wearable, more and more wearables, not just for you, but your diabetic child is in the first grade or going to birthday party and you're worried, do they really understand they can't have the cake or what happened? You can now monitor, did grandma take her medication, et cetera, et cetera. So taking more responsibility for yourself with the help of augmentation. One of the most interesting ones that we can play video number two. This was one I wanted to demo, but they wouldn't let me bring it. Haptics, being able to touch things that aren't there. This is a real glove that comes out right now that you can feel the grains of wheat as you walk through. You can feel a spider crawl on your hand. It's really creepy, and you watch it in VR, and you can feel its little feet do everything. But the most amazing part of this is think of a pinata hanging here on elastic, and I pull the pinata, so there's more tension as the elastic gets stretched. You're feeling that pull back. So, repairing aircraft, doing simulations, lots and lots of jobs that involve touch, assembling fast food. The days when you can afford to have one employee shadow another to learn a skill can now be replaced by VR and some haptics and learning the mechanized things you haven't mechanized. So what's the tipping point? What will suddenly occur to make this jump from 20 billion this year to 140 the next? Glasses. Last year, 2017, in the US, Americans bought over 80 million pairs of glasses for over $100 a pair that only came with one app, Focus. So if it came with a second app, Translate. I went to Angkor Wat last year, really cool. I don't read Cambodian. You know, it'd be nice to know that menu. Oh, I almost ordered the dog, okay? That you can read every single thing in any language, that you can read any sign, or whatever the apps are. 10 years ago, if you look at the first top 10 apps of the first year in the App Store, most of them were pretty lame, because people couldn't figure out what an app should be. Each of you have your top 5 apps that you check every day and couldn't live without nowadays. There's the opportunity. What are the apps that you're going to want in your life? So we talked about unmatched approach in the stadium. So what I want to do is just take you on a customer journey. Any of you in marketing do this all the time. What's a day in the life of my customer? So I want to take your journey coming here to South By, and how would being augmented be different? So I'm sitting there with my checks at the airport. There's my boarding pass. It automatically updates when the gate changes. How many of you have been lost in thought, listening to that cool jam or whatever? They changed the gate and you didn't notice that nobody else is waiting for that flight there anymore, and then you haul it. So, dynamic information, real time. If you are in a business in the 21st century, you do not have a competitive advantage in means of production. You do not have a competitive advantage in recruiting or human capital or location. If you believe you do, you're done. The one advantage you can have in business today is the speed at which you can respond to insights from your data. And as more and more pieces of data are real time, whether you're talking about the digital supply chain or you're talking about CRM, we got real good at online figuring out everything about that person when they come back to that website. But when they walk in your physical store, it's like, who are you? Why are you here? We don't care. So if the companies that figure this out and give that information instantly, you know, I'm a top flyer. I've flown a million miles with that airline. My flight's been canceled. My boarding pass now has become a boarding pass for a different flight. I didn't have to wait in line behind a whole bunch of people that don't fly that often. So then, before you left your hometown, you wanted to see the room of your hotel. If you have rooms, anybody that's ever booked a trip to Hawaii gets a choice. The ocean view for 2x or the garden view for much cheaper. Garden is the Hawaiian word for wall of hotel next to you. And you realize had you stood in that room, you would have paid for the ocean view. That's why you went to Hawaii. So we're working with hospitality companies. Those that do this have a booking rate much higher than those that don't. It's kind of obvious. Now you get in the room, oh my kid doesn't show up under these lights. I'm finding all the bars on 6th of where you want to go, and who's got free booze for Southlight. So you can basically be